Hello, and welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. My name is Mike Parker, and I'm the instructor for the class. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and the handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoy this lesson, please click the like button and subscribe to this channel to be notified when weekly lessons are posted. And if you find this information useful, please share it with a friend. In this lesson, we'll be studying Mosiah chapter 26 through Alma chapter 4. The key individuals in this lesson are Mosiah II was the king of the Nephite people in the land of Zarahemla. Alma I was a former priest of wicked King Noah, who was converted by the preaching of Abinadi. He led 450 converts of Noah's people to Zarahemla, where Mosiah made him high priest over the church. Alma II, the son of Alma I, led many people away from the church of God before he was converted by an angel. He later became chief judge and high priest of the Nephite people. Latter-day Saints sometimes refer to him as Alma the Younger, but the Book of Mormon never calls him that. Ammon, Aaron, Omner, and Himni were the four sons of King Mosiah. They were in league with Alma and were also converted after seeing the angel. Nehor was a Nephite who practiced priestcraft and gathered a large following. Gideon was the former captain of the army of Limhi in the land of Lehi Nephi. By the time of Alma chapter 1, he was an old man. Amalekai was a Nephite who led a rebellion to establish himself as king. We'll discuss how to pronounce his name later in this lesson. Finally, Nephiha was the second chief judge of the Nephites. The outline of events for this lesson. Many of the rising generation in Zarahemla did not join the Church of God and actively sought to lead believers away from it. Mosiah and Alma I determined by revelation how to deal with them. Alma II and the sons of Mosiah were among the young dissenters who persecuted believers. After they were visited in power by an angel of God, they repented of their wickedness. Mosiah's sons embarked on a mission to preach to the Lamanites. Mosiah ended the line of Nephite kings. The Nephites chose to be ruled by judges, and Alma II was appointed to be their first chief judge. Nehor practiced priestcraft. He killed Gideon and was executed for his crimes. The Church of God struggled because Nehor's false teachings had become so widely accepted by its members. Amalekai and his followers joined with the Lamanites to overthrow the Nephite government. Alma and his people successfully defended against the Amalekite rebellion. Because iniquity and pride had become widespread in the Church of God, Alma resigned his position as chief judge and dedicated himself to the ministry. These events took place in the lowlands of Zarahemla, where Mosiah reigned over the Nephite peoples. The material in this lesson begins after Mosiah established Alma I as high priest, circa 123 BC. Approximately 29 years later, Mosiah died and the reign of the judges commenced, circa 94 BC. Alma II resigned the chief judge's seat in the ninth year of the reign of the judges, circa 86 BC. In last week's lesson, we read about the people of Limhi and the people of Alma I, who both escaped the Lamanites in the land of Nephi and fled to the land of Zarahemla. Alma preached and baptized in Zarahemla, and King Mosiah established Alma as high priest over the Church of God. Many of the rising generation were too young at the time to understand King Benjamin's great sermon. Therefore, they did not believe the tradition of their fathers. They refused to be baptized into the Church of God, or even to pray. At first, their numbers were few, but they were soon joined by former believers who defected from the Church of God. Together, these unbelievers did deceive many with their flattering words, who were in the church, and did cause them to commit many sins. When I read these opening verses of chapter 26, I'm struck by their similarity to what we see happening in the church today. Too many of our young people are sadly persuaded by the false social and moral teachings of the world, and they reject the faith of their parents and embrace common beliefs and behaviors advocated by society. There are many voices, especially on online social media, that seek to draw believers away. Too often they succeed. Then, as now, a lack of faith resulted in a lack of knowledge. Because of their unbelief, they could not understand the Word of God, and their hearts were hardened. The teachers of the people brought unrepentant sinners to the priests, and the priest brought them to Alma the First, who was the high priest of the church. Because this was a new problem in the Church of God, there were no procedures on how to deal with it. Alma saw their offenses as criminal acts, so he had the offenders brought before King Mosiah. Mosiah left the matter in Alma's hands, so Alma prayed fervently to know what to do. In response to Alma's petition, he received a revelation from the Lord. The Lord blessed Alma and those who had followed him out of the land of Nephi for their faith and efforts. The Lord promised Alma eternal life and said that those who heard the Lord's voice and were baptized would become his sheep and his church, receive forgiveness of their sins, and receive eternal life. Those who would not hear the Lord's voice, though, would not be redeemed or received into God's church. The Lord then gave instructions to Alma on how to deal with sinners within the church. They were to be judged according to their sins. If they confessed and repented, they would be forgiven by the church and by the Lord. Those who belonged to the church were commanded to forgive one another. Those who would not repent shall not be numbered among my people. Alma wrote down and carried out the Lord's instructions. There was peace and prosperity again in the church, even though persecution from non-believers continued. The believers admonished each other by the word of God, prayed continually, and gave thanks in all things. The persecutions by non-believers became so severe that Alma took the problem to King Mosiah. Mosiah established by decree that non-believers must not persecute believers, and that believers must not persecute each other, but treat each other equally and support themselves with their own hands. The people followed Mosiah's decree, and peace, prosperity, and wealth increased as the people spread out in all directions from the city of Zarahemla. It's at this point that we're introduced to Alma 2 and the four sons of Mosiah. Mosiah 27, verses 8 through 10, quote, "Now the sons of Mosiah were numbered among the unbelievers, and also one of the sons of Alma was numbered among them, he being called Alma after his father. Nevertheless, he became a very wicked and an idolatrous man. And he was a man of many words, and did speak much flattery to the people. Therefore, he led many of the people to do after the manner of his iniquities. And he became a great hindrance to the prosperity of the church of God, stealing away the hearts of the people, causing much dissension among the people, giving a chance for the enemy of God to exercise his power over them. And now it came to pass that while he was going about to destroy the church of God, for he did go about secretly with the sons of Mosiah, seeking to destroy the church, and to lead astray the people of the Lord, contrary to the commandments of God, or even the king," unquote. Alma II and the four sons of King Mosiah, Ammon, Aaron, Omner, and Himni, were part of the rising generation that did not believe in their father's teachings. Alma was the son and namesake of Alma I, the high priest of the Church of God. He was a man of many words who was able to use much flattery to lead many of the people to do after the manner of his iniquities. Their combined objective was to destroy the Church of God. Alma was not the first child of a prophet who used his family name to destroy the testimonies of believers, and he would not be the last. This problem still exists within the church today. The apostate children and close relatives of general authorities have led and will continue to lead people away from and out of the church. Many parents experience difficulty and heartache when their children abandon the teachings of the gospel. Their struggles are often amplified when their children actively fight against the church. Elder John K. Carmack of the 70 gave this counsel, quote, "Some parents suffer greatly because they blame themselves unduly for having been poor parents. In this position, they are likely to misapply President David O. McKay's wonderfully prophetic statement that no other success can compensate for failure in the home. They seem to draw the unintended implication that they must be failures as parents. Hence, no matter how hard they have tried, no other good they have done or success they have achieved can compensate for their parental failure at home. Because this statement was intended to inspire parents to become or stay involved with their children, it should not be taken to mean that parents who have indeed put great time, effort, and sacrifice into parenting, and yet who have still not reaped the desired rewards, have failed." Unquote. Returning to the account of Alma and the sons of Mosiah. Mosiah 27, verses 11 through 17. Quote, "And as I said unto you, as they were going about rebelling against God, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto them, and he descended as it were in a cloud, and he spake as it were with a voice of thunder, which caused the earth to shake upon which they stood. And so great was their astonishment that they fell to the earth, and understood not the words which he spake unto them. Nevertheless he cried again, saying, Alma, arise and stand forth, for why persecutest thou the church of God? For the Lord hath said, This is my church, and I will establish it, and nothing shall overthrow it, save it is the transgression of my people. And again the angel said, Behold, the Lord hath heard the prayers of his people, and also the prayers of his servant Alma, who is thy father. For he has prayed with much faith concerning thee, that thou mightest be brought to the knowledge of the truth. Therefore, for this purpose have I come to convince thee of the power and authority of God, that the prayers of his servants might be answered according to their faith. And now, behold, can ye dispute the power of God? For behold, doth not my voice shake the earth? And can ye not also behold me before you? And I am sent from God. Now I say unto thee, Go, and remember the captivity of thy fathers in the land of Helam, and in the land of Nephi. And remember how great things he has done for them, for they were in bondage, and he has delivered them. And now I say unto thee, Alma, go thy way, and seek to destroy the church no more, that their prayers may be answered, and this even if thou wilt of thyself be cast off. And now it came to pass that these were the last words which the angel spake unto Alma, and he departed. The angel's voice had been so powerful that the earth shook. Alma had collapsed and was unable to speak or move. After the angel departed, the sons of Mosiah carried Alma to his father, who assembled all the people so they might be witnesses of what the Lord hath done for his son. All of this took a full day. The priests of the church fasted and prayed for Alma for 2 more days and nights, after which the young man received his strength and testified of his conversion. Mosiah 27, verses 24 through 31. Quote, "For," said he, "I have repented of my sins and have been redeemed of the Lord. Behold, I am born of the Spirit. And the Lord said unto me, Marvel not that all mankind, yea, men and women, all nations, kindreds, tongues, and people, must be born again, yea, born of God, changed from their carnal and fallen state to a state of righteousness, being redeemed of God, becoming his sons and daughters. And thus they become new creatures. And unless they do this, they can in no wise inherit the kingdom of God. I say unto you, unless this be the case, they must be cast off. And this I know, because I was like to be cast off. Nevertheless, after waiting through much tribulation, repenting nigh unto death, the Lord in mercy hath seen fit to snatch me out of an everlasting burning, and I am born of God. My soul hath been redeemed from the gall of bitterness and bonds of iniquity. I was in the darkest abyss, but now I behold the marvelous light of God. My soul was racked with eternal torment, but I am snatched, and my soul is pained no more. I rejected my Redeemer, and denied that which had been spoken of by our fathers. But now that they may foresee that he will come, and that he remembereth every creature of his creating, he will make himself manifest unto all. Yea, every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess before him. Yea, even at the last day, when all men shall stand to be judged of him, then shall they confess that he is God. Then shall they confess, who live without God in the world, that the judgment of an everlasting punishment is just upon them, and they shall quake and tremble and shrink beneath the glance of his all-searching eye." Unquote. Alma's testimony about the necessity of being born again and becoming sons and daughters of God in verses 24 through 26 echoes King Benjamin's teachings about being spiritually begotten by Christ and being born of him and becoming his sons and his daughters. Alma had been part of the rising generation that could not understand the words of King Benjamin. He now confessed to what Benjamin had taught a generation ago. We'll learn more about what Alma experienced during these 3 days when he testifies to his son Helaman in Alma chapter 36. Alma and the four sons of Mosiah went throughout the land of Zarahemla, zealously striving to repair all the injuries which they had done to the church, confessing all their sins, and publishing all the things which they had seen, and explaining the prophecies and the scriptures to all who desired to hear them. The sons of Mosiah wanted to preach to the Lamanites in the land of Nephi, that perhaps they might bring them to the knowledge of the Lord their God, and cure them of their hatred towards the Nephites. The intensity of their desire was based on the forgiveness they themselves had received from the Lord for their great sins. Their father, King Mosiah, took the matter to the Lord, who approved their request, because many Lamanites shall believe on their words, and they shall have eternal life. Their mission lasted 14 years. That story is told in Alma chapters 17 through 29, which we'll cover in a future lesson. With his sons off to preach to the Lamanites, Mosiah had no heir upon whom he could confer his kingdom. He gathered all the records in his possession, the brass plates, the plates of Nephi, his own records, and the plates discovered by Limhi's people, and gave them, along with the interpreters, to Alma too. Before doing so, Mosiah used the interpreters, those two stones which were fastened into the two rims of a bow, to translate the 24 gold plates of Limhi. We talked about this in our last lesson. From these he learned about the Jaredite people and how they destroyed themselves because of their wickedness. This account did cause the people of Mosiah to mourn exceedingly, yea, they were filled with sorrow. Nevertheless, it gave them much knowledge, in the which they did rejoice. Along with the plates and interpreters, Mosiah also gave Alma a charge that he should keep and preserve them, and also keep a record of the people, handing them down from one generation to another, even as they had been handed down from the time that Lehi left Jerusalem. Mosiah surveyed his people about whom they wanted to succeed him as their king. The people chose his son Aaron, who has already left for the land of Nephi. Neither Aaron nor any of Mosiah's other sons would accept the throne, though. Mosiah wrote an epistle to his people. He expressed his concern that if he selected someone other than Aaron to be king, factions would arise among the Nephites and a civil war would break out. He was also concerned about the possibility that if Aaron did accept the throne, he could return to his former wickedness and drag the people along with him. His objective is found in Mosiah chapter 29, verse 10. "And now let us be wise and look forward to these things," that is to say, plan for the best possible future, "and do that which will make for the peace of this people." Mosiah proposed that the reign of Nephite kings come to an end upon his death, at which time the people would be ruled by a system of judges, to judge this people according to our law, and we will newly arrange the affairs of this people, for we will appoint wise men to be judges that will judge this people according to the commandments of God. He described the potential problems of being ruled by a king and argued why his solution was better. Mosiah 29, verses 21 through 27, quote, "And behold, now I say unto you, ye cannot dethrone an iniquitous king, save it be through much contention and the shedding of much blood. For behold, he has his friends in iniquity, and he keepeth his guards about him, and he teareth up the laws of those who have reigned in righteousness before him, and he trampleth under his feet the commandments of God, and he enacteth laws, and sendeth them forth among his people, yea, laws after the manner of his own wickedness. And whosoever doth not obey his laws, he causeth to be destroyed. And whosoever doth rebel against him, he will send his armies against them to war. And if he can, he will destroy them. And thus an unrighteous king doth pervert the ways of all righteousness. And now, behold, I say unto you, it is not expedient that such abomination should come upon you. Therefore, choose you by the voice of this people judges, that ye may be judged according to the laws which have been given you by our fathers, which are correct, which were given them by the hand of the Lord. Now it is not common that the voice of the people desireth anything contrary to that which is right, but it is common for the lesser part of the people to desire that which is not right. Therefore, this shall ye observe and make it your law, to do your business by the voice of the people. And if the time comes that the voice of the people doth choose iniquity, then is the time that the judgments of God will come upon you. Yea, then is the time that he will visit you with great destruction, even as he has hitherto visited this land." Unquote. Mosiah's warning in verse 27, that if the people chose iniquity, God would visit you with great destruction, even as he has hitherto visited this land, was a reference to the Jaredites, whose record he had just translated, and whose fate was clearly on his mind at that time. The Jaredites' iniquity, selfishness, and hatred for each other had destroyed their civilization, and Mosiah wanted to prevent that from happening to the Nephites. To prevent the self-destruction of the Nephite people, Mosiah proposed a new system of governance based on the rule of judges. This system had the following features. Judges would be chosen by the voice of the people. They would judge matters according to the laws of God. "The voice of the people is the best way to choose," Mosiah wrote, "because the majority of the people typically favor that which is right. If the majority were to choose iniquity," he warned, "then is the time that the judgments of God will come upon you." There would be lower and higher judges. If a lower judge were to judge unrighteously, he could be held accountable by a higher judge. Higher judges who judged unrighteously could be tried by a group of lower judges. This system ensured that no man was above the law. Mosiah again admonished his people to not establish a monarchy, for he wrote, I desire that this inequality should be no more in this land, especially among this my people. But I desire that this be a land of liberty, and every man may enjoy his rights and privileges alike, so long as the Lord sees fit that we may live and inherit the land, yea, even as long as any of our posterity remains upon the face of the land. Critics of the Book of Mormon, who claim that it is a modern composition, have pointed to Mosiah's letter as evidence that its political sentiments came from the world of Joseph Smith. They assert that it represents a rejection of monarchy and an endorsement of democracy, feelings that were ingrained in the American Revolution, the war in which Joseph's grandfathers had fought. That claim, however, is overly simplistic and overlooks key differences between Mosiah's proposed system and the early American form of government. Mosiah's system didn't include legislative or executive branches. Nephite judges didn't have terms of office. They served for life, and their successors were selected, appointed, or limited to the previous judge's descendants. There was also no separation of church and state in the Nephite system of judges. They judged the people according to the commandments of God. The people agreed to Mosiah's system and chose the first judges. Alma, too, was chosen to be the chief judge. His father also conferred upon him the office of high priest over the Church of God. Alma, too, served in both roles simultaneously. Alma, too, served righteously, and there was peace in the land, and thus commenced the reign of the judges. As we'll see, the reign of the judges had mixed results. The system eventually suffered from unrighteous judges who altered the laws and unrighteous people who supported their wickedness. The system lasted 121 years. It collapsed because of corrupt judges, Nephite desertions to the Lamanites, increasing desires among the people for a king, and the resurgence of the Gadianton robbers. Alma I died at age 82. And Mosiah died at age 63, in the 33rd year of his reign. It had now been 509 years since Lehi left Jerusalem, circa 94 BC. We now move into the Book of Alma, the longest book in the Book of Mormon. The heading to the book, which is part of the translated text of the Book of Mormon, indicates that it contains the account of Alma, 2, who was the son of Alma, 1, the first and chief judge over the people of Nephi, and also the high priest over the church, an account of the reign of the judges and the wars and contentions among the people, and also an account of a war between the Nephites and the Lamanites, according to the record of Alma, the first and chief judge. In the first year of the reign of the judges, after the death of King Mosiah, we learn about Nehor, who was described as a man who was large and was noted for his much strength. Nehor advocated publicly for changes in the Church of God, specifically that the priests should become popular, perhaps meaning enjoying the favor of the people, and that they should be supported by the people instead of providing for themselves. He also taught that God had redeemed all people, and therefore everyone would receive eternal life. Nehor's teachings were so well received that people gave him money. He experienced great wealth and pride, and he established his own church. Nehor eventually encountered Gideon, the man who had tried to slay King Noah and had served as captain of King Limhi's army. Gideon was now an old man and a teacher in the church, and he contended with Nehor over Nehor's teachings. Their argument became heated, and Nehor killed Gideon with a sword. The people grabbed Nehor and dragged him before Alma, the chief judge. Alma charged Nehor with teaching priestcraft, preaching and setting oneself up for a light unto the world, that they may get gain and praise of the world, which was forbidden by God. He further charged him with trying to enforce priestcraft by violence and of murdering Gideon. Alma condemned Nehor to death, and Nehor was executed on the hill Manti after confessing his wrongs. Nehor's death didn't stop his ideas from spreading, however. Priestcraft and other false doctrines spread throughout the land. There was no law against a man's honest beliefs, so those who belonged to the order of Nehor couldn't be judged so long as they didn't commit other crimes. Those who followed Nehor's teachings began to persecute those who were of the Church of God. The members of the Church of God began to argue and fight with the followers of Nehor, contrary to the laws of God. In the second year of the Judges, circa 92 BC, there was a wave of apostasy and excommunications within the Church of God, but the remaining members of the church remained steadfast, immovable, and patient. The priests and the members of the church dedicated extra time to preaching, giving to the needy, and remaining humble. Despite the persecutions they endured, they established peace among themselves, and they were blessed materially. Those outside the church gave themselves to all manner of wickedness. This continued through the fifth year of the Judges. In the fifth year of the reign of the Judges, circa 90 BC, another man rose to prominence. Amalekai, a follower of Nehor's religion, was a very cunning man, yea, a wise man as to the wisdom of the world. In the printer's manuscript of the Book of Mormon, Amalekai is always spelled with a C, but the first two instances of Amalekites in Alma chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, are spelled with a K. This suggests that Joseph Smith pronounced Amalekai's name with a hard K sound, rather than a soft S like Amlici. Amalekai's followers wanted to put an end to the judges and establish Amalekai as king. This would have been a catastrophe, as Amalekai would have used his power as king to do away with the Church of God. People throughout the land did assemble themselves together to cast in their voices concerning the matter. When they brought their decisions before the judges, the voice of the people came against Amalekai, that he was not made king over the people. This defeat didn't stop Amalekai's followers. They consecrated Amalekai as king, and he ordered them to take up arms and use force to subject those who didn't accept him. His followers called themselves Amalekites. The Nephites, with Alma as their leader, met the Amalekites in battle at the hill Amnihu, east of Zarahemla. Thousands of combatants were killed on both sides, but nearly twice as many Amalekites as Nephites perished. The Nephites pursued the Amalekites to the Valley of Gideon, where they sent four spies to discover the Amalekites' battle plans. The spies returned in haste with frightening news. A Lamanite army had come down from the land of Nephi to join the Amalekites and was gathering in the land of Minon with the intent of marching on the city of Zarahemla. The Nephites, who were hopelessly outnumbered, retreated toward Zarahemla, but the combined Amalekite-Lamanite armies fell upon them as they crossed the river Sidon. The Nephites prayed mightily and were strengthened by the hand of the Lord. Alma cried out in prayer, "O Lord, have mercy and spare my life, that I may be an instrument in thy hands to save and preserve this people." Alma fought Amalekai in single combat and slew him. He also fought with the Lamanite king. Alma and his men drove back the Lamanites and opened a way for the Nephite army to cross to the west bank of the Sidon. They threw the dead bodies of their enemies into the river and continued to fight their pursuers. After all the parties had crossed to the west bank of the Sidon, the tide of the battle turned in the Nephites' favor. The Amalekite-Lamanite armies fled before the Nephites towards the wilderness, which was west and north. The Nephites pursued and killed many of them, and the rest died of their wounds or were eaten by wild beasts in the wilderness of Hermounts. After burying their many dead, the Nephite army returned to their lands. Many Nephite women and children had been killed, and flocks, herds, and many fields of grain destroyed. Mormon paused here to explain the practice of the Amalekites and their connection to the Lamanites. The Amalekites, he wrote, marked themselves with red in their foreheads, after the manner of the Lamanites. The Lamanites shaved their heads and wore only loincloths. As Nephi had described, the skins of the Lamanites were dark according to the mark which was set upon their fathers, which was a curse upon them because of their transgression and their rebellion against their brethren. This was so they might be distinguished from the Nephites and prevent the false traditions of the Lamanites from destroying the Nephites. Nephites who joined the Lamanites received the same curse. Whosoever suffered himself to be led away by the Lamanites was called under that head, and there was a mark set upon him. All those who shared the beliefs of the Nephites and kept the commandments of God were called the Nephites, or the people of Nephi, from that time forth. Having allied themselves with the Lamanites, the Amalekites had fallen under the curse Mormon had just described, and they had marked themselves with red on their foreheads. This fulfilled a prophecy of the Lord given to Nephi. The Amalekites had brought this curse upon themselves through their actions, even though they didn't know they were fulfilling prophecy. To understand the Lamanite curse better, see the discussion of 2 Nephi chapter 5 in lesson 6. I've included a link to that in the show notes for this video. Later that same year, another army of Lamanites came to battle against the Nephites in the same location as the previous battle, and again they were defeated. Mormon explained his reason for including the accounts of these battles in his record. Alma 3, verses 26 and 27, quote, "And in 1 year were thousands and tens of thousands of souls sent to the eternal world, that they might reap their rewards according to their works, whether they were good or whether they were bad, to reap eternal happiness or eternal misery according to the spirit which they listed to obey, whether it be a good spirit or a bad one. For every man receiveth wages of him whom he listeth to obey, and this according to the words of the spirit of prophecy. Therefore, let it be according to the truth. And thus endeth the fifth year of the reign of the judges." Unquote. In the sixth year of the reign of the judges, circa 89 BC, the Nephites continued to mourn their dead and the loss of their flocks and fields. Their humility led them to remember their religious obligations, and they began to establish the church more fully. Many people were baptized into the Church of God. In the seventh year of the reign of the judges, circa 88 BC, 3,500 were baptized into the Church of God. In the eighth year, circa 87 BC, the people of the church began to experience pride because of their prosperity. They became vain, scornful, and envious, and they contended among themselves and with those not of the church. This grieved Alma and other leaders in the church. In the ninth year, circa 86 BC, Alma saw the wickedness of the church, and he saw also that the example of the church began to lead those who were unbelievers on from one piece of iniquity to another, thus bringing on the destruction of the people. There were still people in the church who believed and lived the doctrines of Christ, but they were persecuted by their wicked brethren. These developments troubled Alma so much that he decided to devote himself full-time to the ministry. He resigned his position as chief judge, turning the office over to a wise man named Nephihah. Alma 4, verses 19 and 20, quote, "And this he did, that he himself might go forth among his people, or among the people of Nephi, that he might preach the word of God unto them, to stir them up in remembrance of their duty, and that he might pull down by the word of God all the pride and craftiness and all the contentions which were among his people, seeing no way that he might reclaim them, save it were in bearing down in pure testimony against them. And thus, in the commencement of the ninth year of the reign of the judges over the people of Nephi, Alma delivered up the judgment seat to Nephihah, and confined himself wholly to the high priesthood of the holy order of God, to the testimony of the word, according to the spirit of revelation and prophecy." unquote. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. In our next lesson, we'll discuss Alma's ministry and teachings in the land of Zarahemla and his partnership with Amulek. The reading is Alma chapters 5 through 16. See you next time.